more you do that, the more likely it is that some sort of spillover event is going to happen. Disturb natural ecosystems, we put people in contact or closer contact with wildlife. And so this just increases the risk. It's sort of a probability game. With date palm, that means that the bats that used to live in the forest are now roosting and foraging for food in the date palm plantations. And that is what allowed spillover of, you know, something like Nipah virus, for example, in Malaysia. If we think about something like Lyme disease, which is really common in the Northeast, when we fragment forests and we create new suburban developments for housing for people, that puts people in closer contact with ticks that might be infected with the pathogen that causes Lyme disease. And so, you know, often it's a matter of what we're replacing the forest with and how that changes interactions between people and wildlife. Places where subsistence livelihoods are an important driver of deforestation. If we can find ways to alleviate poverty in these regions and find alternative livelihood options, that may help a lot. Even making alternative cooking fuels available, making it so that these people don't have to go into the forest, cut them down to create charcoal to be able to cook their meals. Another thing that I think is really helpful is the quality of monitoring that we can do of forests using things like land use planning. Landscapes need to provide people with food and fiber, housing, you know, these are things that we can't get away from, but maybe we can plan land use in a way that sort of sustainably balances our needs with conservation of forests.